In this video, I'm going to break down one of the most essential concepts in CSS, the box model, that makes styling your web page feel logical rather than frustrating. By the end of this video, you'll be confidently using properties like padding, margin, display, box sizing, and more. I'm going to share with you 5 common problems that separate the experienced CSS developers from the beginners. 1. Why setting width and height sometimes has no effect on elements like anchors, spans, or buttons. 2. Why top and bottom, padding, margin, and border might not push other inline elements away the way you expect. 3. Why 4 boxes with width 25% plus padding and border can exceed 100% of their container width. 4. Why most professional developers love and use box sizing border box in all of their projects. 5. What is margin collapsing? So let's get started. Everything in CSS is a box. Every element you see on a web page, whether it's text, an image, or even a button, is actually a box that you can control. You can set its size, its position, give it a background image, border, and more. The CSS box model is simply like the rule book that tells you how these boxes work or behave. Sometimes they behave just the way you expect, and sometimes they can be a bit weird or unpredictable. Once you understand these rules, though, CSS suddenly starts making a lot more sense, and you can build layouts that work exactly the way you want. Now, let's dive into the parts of a box. Think of a box like a photo frame that holds a picture. There are 4 key parts to every box. The content. This is your actual content, like text, image, or whatever else is inside. It's like the photo itself. The padding. This is the space between the content and the border. The border. The line that goes around your content and padding. The margin, the space between this box and other boxes around it. This is like the space you leave between different framed photos when hanging them on your wall. Now let's look at each part in detail. Padding can be set using the padding property, which applies the same value in all 4 directions. But if you need to adjust a specific side, you can use padding left, padding right, padding top, or padding bottom. You can also set different values in one go. It goes clockwise from a top. If you specify only 2 values, the first one applies to the top and bottom, and the second one to the left and right. With 3 values, the first is top, the second is left and right, and the third is bottom. One thing to note, padding can never be negative. If I set a background color to a box, the background displays behind both the content and the padding. This is because padding is inside the box. So, the box's background is visible in the space it creates. And if the content overflows and you get scroll bars, those scroll bars will occupy that same space. Next up is the border. Creating a border around a box involves 3 properties: border width, border style, and border color. You can set them all at once. Just like with padding, you can target specific sides using border left, border right, border top, and border bottom separately, or adjust their widths, styles, or colors individually. Now, let's look at the margin. Margins create space between your box and other boxes around it. Like padding, you can set it using margin for all 4 sides. Margin left, margin right, margin top, and margin bottom for individual sides or the shorthand methods. Now, when should you use margin versus padding? Use padding when the space feels like it's part of the element itself. Use margin when the space is about separating one element from others around it. Now, let's talk about something interesting. Consider these 2 boxes. One has margin right 20 pixels, and the other has margin left 50 pixels. How much space would be between them horizontally? 70 pixels, right? But what if these boxes were stacked vertically, with one having margin bottom 20 pixels and the other having margin top 50 pixels? The space between them would actually be 50 pixels, not 70 pixels. This happens because of something called margin collapsing. When top and bottom margins of different elements touch, they don't add together. Instead, they overlap, and only the larger margin applies. This is called margin collapsing. For 2 positive margins, the larger one wins. For 2 negative margins, the one that's furthest from 0 wins. And if one is negative and one is positive, they subtract. Think of it like this. Imagine you and I are sitting on a bench. You feel comfortable when no one sits at least 20 pixels near you. And for me, that comfortable space is 50 pixels. If we sit together, we don't need to have 70 pixels of space between us. The larger of our comfortable spaces will work for both of us. Note that margin collapsing only happens in the vertical direction, and it won't occur inside a container that's set to display, flex, or grid. Now let's talk about another interesting problem. Imagine we have four boxes in a container that's 100% of the viewport width. For each box, we set a padding of 10 pixels, a 4 pixels wide solid green border, and the width to be 25%. Logically, these four boxes should fit perfectly in the container since 4 times 25% equals 100%. But they don't. They overflow and break our layout. Why does this happen? By default, browsers have box sizing for an element set to content box. This means when you set a width or height, you're only setting the width or height of the content box, not including padding or border. So, in our example, the total size of each box becomes the sum of its left padding, left border, the 25% width, right border, and right padding. This adds up to more than 25% per box. So our four boxes exceed 100% of the container width. The solution to this problem is the box sizing CSS property. It lets us change how the total width and height of an element is calculated. The default box sizing content box gives the behavior I just described. If we set the width of an element to 100 pixels, the content box will be 100 pixels wide, but the actual rendered element will be wider because of padding and border. But if we set box sizing border box, the width or height we set includes the border, padding, and content. If we set the width to 100 pixels, the entire box, including border and padding, will be 100 pixels and the content box will shrink to fit. This makes layout much more predictable. What you set is what you get. This is why most professional developers like to have this reset for all elements in their projects. In fact, February 1st is even declared as International Box Sizing Awareness Day. Here's the code many developers use to apply BorderBox to all elements. A great way to see the box model in action is to right-click on any element on a web page and select Inspect to open your browser's developer tools. You'll see a diagram that shows you exactly how the box model is applied, including the size of the element, its margin, padding, and border. Inspecting elements this way is a great way to find out if your box is really the size you think it is. Every browser applies a user agent style sheet to HTML, which varies between browsers. This defines how elements should look and behave if they don't have defined CSS. If you want to see every box on the page, you can add a little CSS like this. This adds a red outline around every element without changing your layout. If we had done this with border instead of outline, it would add to the size of the box and disturb our layout. Properties like outline and box shadow occupy space outside the box because they are painted on top of the element and don't affect the box's size. Now that we know how boxes are sized, let's talk about how they behave with other boxes around them. This is controlled by the display property. Elements like paragraphs, divs, headings, and sections have display block by default. Block elements always start on a new line and take up the full width available, unless you specify otherwise. It's like saying, I need my personal space. No one sitting beside me in this row. They respect width and height properties. Any padding, margin, or border will push other elements away from the box. Then there are inline elements, such as anchors and spans. These don't break onto a new line, and their width and height properties are ignored. Padding, margin, and border apply. Left and right, padding, margin, and border will push other elements away, just like block elements. But top and bottom, padding, margin, and border won't push other inline elements away. Inline block elements give you the best of both worlds. They sit next to each other like inline elements, but they also respect width and height like block elements. This means padding, margin, and border will push other elements away, yet they won't automatically break onto a new line. This is useful for things like giving padding to links for a larger clickable area, or for buttons that need to sit side by side, but also need precise sizing. What we discussed so far, block, inline, and inline block, are actually outer display types. Boxes also have inner display types. Outer display types affect how the box is laid out in relation to other boxes around it. Inner display types determine how elements inside that box are laid out. You can change the inner display type by setting values like display flex or display grid. The element will still use the outer display type block, but this changes how its children behave. Any direct children of this box will become flex or grid items and follow the rules of flexbox or grid. Flexbox and grid are powerful layout systems that can seem intimidating at first, but they're absolutely game-changing once you learn them. If you feel a bit overwhelmed by all such CSS concepts, or you're not sure what to learn next on your web development journey, I've got something special for you. In this video, I've shared why the Odin Project, a completely free, open source, and comprehensive curriculum, is one of the best resources to jumpstart your journey in web development.